Guess where I am this week? That's right, Paris. Sorry, apparently it's not Paris, it's Sydney. The Eiffel Tower, isn't it?
Today, I pick up some tips on the more intricate ways of eating and drinking. I travel out of Sydney to visit one of the country's oldest wine companies and learn the process of producing fine wines. And also, I get high, in the sky, with a dose of vitamin G-force.
Feel the need for speed.
All these moments, of course, captured on Sony's brilliant Alpha NEX3.
Sounds like a truly fun-filled and intoxicating day for me. And I use that word in every possible sense imaginable.
Let's get things started.
Along with me for the ride today, I have my trusty Alpha NEX3, the ultimate and perfect companion for soaking up the Sydney sights in one fell swoop. Not exactly ideal for soaking up the wine though, but that's what I'm here for.
I took a scenic walk around Sydney's city centre with the Alpha NEX3, a sibling of the Alpha NEX5, whose slim, stylish, compact, and despite its small size, produces DSLR image quality.
The NEX3 comes in a variety of colours. You can get the slim-bodied camera with the interchangeable lens in black, white, silver, and of course, my perennial favourite, red. Wow, I love Sydney. So photogenic.
I love capturing DSLR quality pictures without the weight of a conventional DSLR camera in my hands. The Alpha NEX3 is light, compact, and so easy to use. See? No complicated buttons. Not only that, it's designed for the perfect grip. Now, let's take this baby on the road. There's nothing better than exploring a new city with a camera that makes you feel like a professional photographer with every shot.
I love Sydney. It's a real pretty city, and this farmer's market is killing me. I'm absolutely starving. To go look for breakfast. I'm just gonna follow my nose. Great morning in Sydney. Gorgeous light, got some nice photos. It's a bit cold though. Maybe I should go somewhere, get some breakfast and warm up a bit. Maybe I should get something harder and warm myself up a bit.
On a sunny winter morning like this, nothing beats hanging out at a place like Delicado Foods, one of Sydney's best wine and restaurant bars. Not only does it have a wide selection of delicious cheese and tapas, it's also home to a large wine collection that leaves me drooling.
You know the feeling that a moth has right before it hits the flame?
That's me right now.
Delicado Foods offers a wide range of Spanish and other European wines. With more than 500 varieties to choose from, I'm in seventh heaven.
Ooh. I want that one.
This could get out of hand.
Ooh. I want that one.
As owner of Delicado and sommelier extraordinaire with more than 20 years of experience under his belt, Ben Moechtar was just the person I needed to speak to.
Ah, you look like a man that can help me. You must be Ben. Hello, I'm Oli.
I am.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well. You look like you got your arms full.
Yes, absolutely. I hear you're a bit of an expert on wine, right?
It's part of my day job.
Maybe you could help me out, guide me through your world and educate me a little bit.
Yeah, certainly. Let's talk food and wine.
Let's drink some too.
Yeah.
Okay.
Come with me.
Okay, this is my idea of breakfast. So where do we begin?
I think we should probably start with a nice, crisp, dry sherry.
I think we should too. A crisp, dry sherry for breakfast.
This is from Andalusia, down in the south of Spain. Ooh. It's a fortified wine, so...
I'm a fortified host, so it's okay.
I was going to say, just take it slow.
Haha, my breakfast is already starting out on a good note.
When it comes to sort of tasting wine, you know, like this, what am I supposed to do? Because I'm always doing this. Because I see people do this on TV, but what am I actually doing when I do this, apart from looking like a genius?
When you swirl a glass of wine like that, you release the volatile aromas. Mm-hmm. So it basically concentrates what you can smell. Everyone smells and tastes different things, and there's no right and wrong.
Next up, a cheeky Spanish Tempranillo from the region of Rioja, a red, medium-bodied, dry and savoury wine that goes perfectly with Delicado's signature dish.
This here is a chicken stuffed with sobrasada, which is a type of chorizo.
Wow.
And a mushroom and a corn ragu. You have a look at that inside.
So it's sort of minced chorizo, okay, cool.
That's delicious.
Oh. I've obviously been doing my breakfast all wrong for the last 15 years of my life.
It's never too late to change.
I'm completely with you. Today is my day of education and change.
So, Oli, we've finished with the tapas, and we've come full circle now. We're going to go back to sherry.
Oh, really? Okay.
To finish off the meal. What we have is a very special wine from Jerez. It's called Cardinal Cisneros. Mm-hmm. That's the nectar of the god.
Wow.
Yeah.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Wow, it's like syrup.
And then it just coats the whole palate.
Yeah.
It's just gorgeous.
It is.
This is one of the few wines in the world that actually matches chocolate.
Really?
Because chocolate is so intensely sweet, you need a wine that's equally intense. And if it's equally as sweet, it just marries so well.
I see. Yeah. Well, this is blindingly sweet. But what do we have here? It looks great.
Well, this is churros, which is a traditional Spanish dessert.
Dessert for breakfast? Now that's what I call living it up.
Breakfast of champions. There we go.
Oh, cheers.
I mean, this has all been Spanish wine. It's been fantastic Spanish food as well, but we are in Australia. Don't you guys make wine here in Australia? Don't you? It's pretty good.
We make absolutely fantastic wine in Australia.
So if I wanted to go, I mean, I'm in Sydney now. Is there anywhere close to here where I could go maybe visit a vineyard or see them making wine, things like that?
Well, just a couple of hours north, maybe 2 hours, is the Hunter Valley, which is one of our most historic wine regions.
Yeah, I could do that. Just jet up there this afternoon. Sounds like a plan. Seems like I should be going hunting in that valley for more wine. Not that this hasn't been fantastic. Cheers. You're a legend.
Thank you.
That, ladies and gentlemen, is how you start your day, but by the sounds of it, my day's only just begun. Strap in, Hunter Valley. Ollie's on the way.
Myself traveling out of the city on the way to Hunter Valley. Located approximately 120 kilometers north of Sydney, it's a scenic 2-hour drive up to Australia's oldest wine area. Vineyards were first established in the area in the 1830s. Since then, the area has grown in size, with most of the original family still living there. Hunter Valley is home to some 120 wineries, ranging from famous labels to boutique winemakers. I decided to visit Tyrrell's Wine, one of the leading winemakers in Australia, to truly understand wine.
Look at that. Gorgeous. Makes the 2-hour journey from Sydney just about worthwhile. I'm at Tyrrell's Vineyards, one of the oldest vineyards around here. In fact, it's been run by the same family for 5 generations. In fact, that's who I'm about to meet, the 5th generation. He's going to take me around, teach me about wine, and help me engage in my passion. Alcohol.
Chris Tyrrell is an assistant winemaker of Tyrrell's Wine. Having grown up in the family business, Chris agreed to give me a tour of their oldest vineyard.
Well, Ollie, this is our 4 acres vineyard. It's called 4 acres because, funnily enough, the size of the vineyard is 4 acres.
I never would have guessed it.
And the great thing about this vineyard is it was planted in 1879, which makes it one of the oldest Shiraz vineyards, not just in Australia, but in the world.
Whoa. So you're saying this is like the same vine that's been here for 150 years?
Same vine, yeah. If you actually pulled these vines out, the roots would actually be about 20, 25 foot under the ground.
Good lord.
Yeah, so they're pretty tough for
well, they look
for 130, 30 years old.
They look like they're carved out of stone.
Yeah, so this is the grandfather block, I call them. When they get this old, the fruit has a different character, more concentration and just more complexity. So this little block generally only makes 300 to 400 cases.
And how many bottles in a case?
12.
All right, so not many.
Not many, no.
What's it like, I mean, being fifth generation? It's like there's a real family history to this.
It's a humbling sort of feeling you get. You know, we're standing here in this vineyard talking about these vines, and you know, my great-grandfather who planted them would have been doing exactly the same thing. Mm-hmm. Tyrrell's is, it's a lot bigger than just one generation or two generations, so I just see myself as, you know, just getting it through and improving on it. You know, if you can hand it on in better condition than when you got it, then you've probably done your job.
As the generations go on, does the sort of the slant of the brand sort of change?
I guess if you look through the history of Tyrrell's, it has been a bit like that. And my grandfather loved drinking white Burgundies, Chardonnay from the Burgundy region in France. So he thought, well, bugger this, they're too expensive, I can make them myself. So he got hold of some Chardonnay vines and that went from there. And then my father has been really focused on Semillon as a variety and the single vineyard Semillon.
So where do you see you going?
I don't know, I guess the next one, maybe red Shiraz. But we're very proud of the things we make.
Well, I'd be attached to this area as well. There's so much history, you can almost feel it.
It's not a bad place, yeah.
What's the sort of the length of time then? I mean, average, I understand that it can vary, but from, you know, grape to bottle to my stomach.
For a red wine, 18 months. But for instance, a white might be more like 6 or 7 months.
Really?
Yeah.
I always thought it was longer than that. It only takes me 6 or 7 minutes to consume it, so I suppose I can understand. Well, thanks a lot, mate. That was very cool. But do you reckon there's any chance I could get inside to see some of the bottling and the whatever you guys do in there?
Yeah, we can take you inside now, and Andrew can show you around, and we'll show you the deepest, darkest secrets of Tyrrell's. Let's go.
I like. You'll let me taste some of the wine then, right?
Of course.
Okay, good. It's important.
As the chief winemaker of Tyrrell's wine, Andrew Spinazzi has been closely guarding the secrets of Tyrrell's winemaking techniques for the past 30 years. Good to know I'll be getting the lowdown from the master himself.
All right then, mate. You by any chance, Andrew?
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Oli.
Hey, Oli.
Nice to meet you. Chris just sent me and said you're the man to talk to if I want to see how wine becomes wine.
Sure.
So what's step one?
Well, we might start probably over at the basket press.
Okay.
Okay?
Sounds like a plan.
Good. So, Oli, what we have here is a very old basket press.
How old?
About 120 years of age.
Really?
Yeah.
Look at that.
And for about 30-odd years, this press just stayed as it is. And about 4 years ago, I put some new boards on and reinvigorated the machine. And this is a really important press for some of our best quality wines that we make. We get better chemistry from the juice using this technique. And in the end product, we're getting a lot more texture and flavor.
So it's sort of essentially you guys have done full circle. You come right back to the way you were doing it before.
We have indeed.
For all the top end stuff as well.
All the top end stuff.
There you go. See? You want top end wine, you've got to do it the traditional way.
We still use the modern techniques. I mean, they obviously still have a place because of our amount of production.
So once you pressed it, then what? Where do we move on to?
Basically, the basket press is for white production. Mm-hmm. Where we're clarifying or getting the juice away from the white skins. With our red production over here, we use what we call open fermentation.
Okay, so we check.
We'll go and have a look, eh? Yeah. This is the original vats from the 1800s, early 1800s, which we still use today.
Wow.
Each vat takes about 2 ton of red crushed fruit. The grapes stay here for about 5 days of fermentation. During that period, and the fermentation starts, the skins rise to the top because of the CO2 lifting the skins. We actually plunge the skins back down using this technical bit of stick. We push back down, and that releases both the CO2 heat that's generated in fermentation and extracts the colour out of the skins. After about 4 or 5 days, then the grapes go from here into wood.
Okay, into the barrels.
Into the barrels.
So then let's go check out the barrels.
Okay.
Can we open
to the barrel room?
Yeah. Well, this is a bit bigger than I was imagining. This is huge.
Yeah, sure, Oli. Well, there's a reason for that. Not all wines want too much oak. So for some of our medium body styles, which we're famous for around here, we don't want to extract too much oak flavour into those wines, which is the reason we use these bigger barrels of 2,500 litres.
Wow. So how many bottles can you fit into one of these?
This barrel holds 300 cases.
And there's 12 bottles a case?
That's it.
Wow. So what do we have in here?
This is one of the oldest vineyards we take, and it's actually a vineyard called Stevens, mm-hmm. Which was first planted in 1867.
Wow, okay, in 1867, let's try it.
Okay, this is the 2010 Shiraz. So this was fermented, or piqued and fermented about 3 months ago, four mm-hmm. months ago.
But it's good to taste.
Sure.
It smells good. Ooh. I just can't bring myself to spit it down, it's too good.
Thank you so much. It's been fascinating for me, I have to say.
Pleasure, Ollie.
It's been a pleasure for me too.
How cool was that? Much as I'd love to stay there and try to drink them out of business, I think I'd regret it eternally if I didn't whip out my NEX3 and try and use the amazing sweet panorama mode here, because look, it's like the exact definition of a panorama. That is cool. You know what? Very soon it's going to get cooler. The NEX3, like its brother, the NEX5, will soon be bringing us panoramas in 3D. Take it home, hook it up to your Bravia LX900, and you'll be getting the Hunter Valley panorama in beautiful, mind-blowing 3D. Now that is seriously cool. What a day. How could I possibly top it? I mean, I've been all over Sydney, I've been to some great places, tried some fantastic wine. I know, why don't I go up in a plane and scare myself half to death? That sounds like fun. Good thing I've been drinking.
In the sleepy town of Hunter Valley, where the greenery is lush and the vineyards are thriving, there lies a hidden gem for those who seek a thrill from greater heights.
You know, Hunter Valley's a quiet place, you know, very slow moving. They grow their vines, they pick their grapes, they make their wine, they watch it mature, they chill out. So I thought I'd ramp it up a bit. Thought I'd go up in the air, do some aerobatics. Don't worry, not in that thing. I'm not gonna be torpedoing anything, but it'll still be fun.
Ah, you must be Phil.
I must be Phil.
I'm Ollie, mate.
Ollie, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
How are you doing?
I'm excited. I hear you're the man to come see if I want to have fun in the Hunter
Valley. Absolutely. That's us. That's me. That's me.
So what are we going to be doing? Is this our...
That's our aeroplane.
As Phil gives me a dose of what I'm to be expecting, I can't help but start feeling like a little boy about to get on his first roller coaster ride.
We'll have a look at a hammerhead or stall turn where we can demonstrate some vertical flight to you. So we pitch up to the vertical, absolutely vertical.
Yeah.
Absolutely straight up until we get to the top where we're going very slowly. And then we're going to curve around like a cartwheel around that inside wing tip onto a vertical down line. And then,
well, so how long have you been a pilot, Phil?
32 years.
Oh, okay.
But that's... remember, I was only 18 months old.
I was a child prodigy. What sort of G's can I expect to be feeling while we're up there?
Today we probably won't go beyond about 5.
5? I like the sound of that. Wow, so is there anything special about this plane?
Lots of things are special about this aeroplane. Ollie, it's a Pitts Special, which has become a cult aeroplane now. They were designed originally back in 1944 as high-performance aerobatic aeroplanes, and they're so good that they still build them. And they've been known as the Ferrari of the sky.
Ferrari of the sky? Really?
That's the one.
Well, it sounds like we've got the right aircraft. Sounds like we've got the right pilot, too.
Oh, you're so kind.
The moment of truth has arrived. Can I handle being turned upside down at more than 2,000 feet? It's my Top Gun moment. I can't wait. I think I'm ready. Phil, of course, came through on his promises. First up, we had the winger. Then the hesitation roll. And then the fabled hammerhead. But the highlight was, of course, the barrel roll, which basically had me turned upside down and then back up again. It was awesome. There is nothing like being turned upside down about 2,500 feet above the earth looking down and seeing the ground instead of the sky. It's so quick, it's so maneuverable. I mean, I did the whole thing with this massive smile on my face. You should see it. You think the Hunter Valley is beautiful, you should see it from a plane while screaming like a big kid.
There you go, Ollie. How was that?
That was mind-blowingly cool.
You're done.
Woo! You are the man.
Well done.
Thank you.
Glad you had fun.
That was, to anybody watching, trust me, if you want to top off your day in the best possible way, get thrown about in the air. That was, whoa. I'm coming back tomorrow. That's, oh.
I don't know about you guys, but I think Australia rocks. I mean, it's not every day you get to have wine for breakfast, some more wine for lunch, and then spend your afternoon hanging upside down from a plane screaming like a big girl at 3,000 feet. I think it's time for me to slow things down a bit. Maybe I should check my photos. In the meantime, why don't you guys enjoy this behind the scenes look at Shakira's anthem for the FIFA World Cup, Waka Waka.
It's time for Africa.
It's my Shakira impression. It's very bad.
And action.
We're here at the set of our video, Waka Waka, this time for Africa. The song that has been just selected to be the anthem of the World Cup.
You're a good soldier, choosing your battles. Pick yourself up and dust yourself off and back in the saddle.
We're very excited about it. It's been a great experience, especially shooting this video for the first time, my first video in 3D.
Because this is Africa. Tamina.
We have two cameras, that's what you need to shoot 3D.
We focus on a back plane, foreground, gets all technical, but it makes this other dimension come alive. And that's what we're doing with Shakira, and it's all about World Cup soccer.
This time for Africa.
I'm Hi-Hat, I'm the choreographer in the Shakira video. I had like 150 dancers trying to teach them the Waka Waka dance.
Shakira's producer was downstairs from our producer, and he walked up the stairs and he said, here's this track that Shakira wants to offer up for the World Cup song. So we gave it our own freshly ground spin.
I hope you enjoy it as much as I have.
Cause this is Africa.
With that, we come to the end of an awesome day in Sydney, and if I don't say so myself, a rather awesome episode of Sony Style. Make sure you join me, Oli Pettigrew, for more of the same next week, same time, same place, and most likely, less wine.